time, are there any additions to the agenda? Okay, so we'll call it to order and approve the agenda as presented, please. Okay, Counselor Stewart, Counselor Croft. All those in favor? Contrary, motion carries. Adoption of the minutes of the regular council meeting held June 11. Okay, thank you, Counselor Dable, Counselor Stewart. Questions or comments pertaining to the minutes? All those in favor? Thank you very much. No delegations at this point. Okay. Item 5A, report from our Director of Corporate Services pertaining to appointment of Deputy Chief Election Official for the 2018 General Local Government Elections. Mr. Orlovsky or Ms. Bellingham, whoever would like to speak to this, Ms. Bellingham?
Although we have appointed a Chief Election Officer and a Deputy Chief Election Officer, I'm sort of a resource for them in the background. However, if they get called upon during advanced voting or general voting, I don't want to attend a voting site as a corporate officer title. It would be more prudent to come in as a Deputy Chief Election Officer.
Okay. So if someone gets sick as well, would that, that would give the opportunity to step in?
Yes.
Okay. Sounds like a good common sense suggestion. Do we have a motion that pursuant to Section 58, subsections 1 and 2 of the Local Government Act, that Donna Bellingham be appointed Deputy Chief Election Officer for the 2018 General Local Elections? Motion that effect, please. Okay. Councilor Erickson moving. Seconder? Councilor Stewart? Okay.
Thank you, through you. So you would actually only be attending in that capacity if you were required to, because I don't want to see us spending additional money on your position, sorry to say, but, you know, reality, right? So, okay.
Sure. Only on an as-need basis.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
That's going to be a woman to
myself. Yeah.
All right, thanks.
Yep. Unfortunately for Ms. Bellingham, no extra pay for Ms. Bellingham. Well, this is part of responsibility, so there you go.
One help.
Okay, motion's on the table. All those in favor? Contrary. Motion carries. Thank you. Item B, report from our Director of Finance pertaining to the 2017 annual report. Mr. Cordes.
Thank you, Your Worship. As for the community charter, section 9899 require that we prepare an annual report for council's consideration. A council or other public meeting. Our report was made available to the public back on June 8th. There's copies of the counter on the website. And we have to have it approved by the June 30 legislative deadline. So it's here for tonight to have council approve the 2017 annual report.
Okay,
do
we have a motion that effect? Councilor Croft, Councilor Erickson.
Yeah,
good work on that. Mm-hmm. Motion's on the table. All those in favor? Contrary, motion carries. Thank you so much. Item C, report from our Director of Finance, Mr. Cordes, pertaining to the purchasing policy amendment that we talked about last meeting. Mr. Cordes.
Thank you, Your Worship. This is basically a housekeeping item. The restructure, reorganization of the public works part of that last year. There's a couple position changes and some positions were eliminated. So the changes that you see in the policy are in red. We're just basically changing, removing the foreman and inserting the operations manager. And then there's one wording change under the credit card area there underneath operations manager. I'm just saying that the cards may be amended, not will be. And that's basically, that's the only changes. And then there was another change just relating to the same thing, removing foreman and adding manager of operations on, I guess, page 6 of the policy or page 64 of the package. And those are the other changes. So it's just to bring it up to date.
Okay, sounds good. Motion to adopt. Okay, Mr. Dable.
Second.
Councilor Medlock. All those in favor?
Contrary.
Motion carries. Thank you. And then we have item D, report from our Director of Operations, Mr. Dickin, pertaining to the pollution control project, and I guess the floor is yours, Mr. Dick.
Thank you, Your Worship, Council. I get to be the one tonight to be the bearer of bad news, I suppose. So as you know, we're under an existing funding agreement with the province. We received a grant in the amount of $2.4 million, which would be the province and the Fed's share of a $2.93 million project, which we are operating on 17 cent dollars from the District of Hope, which has gone a long way to get some important upgrades out of the Pollution Control Center. So we recently completed stage one, which involved deselecting the lagoons, installing new aeration system in the lagoons, as well as new flow control structures between the three lagoons that we have. And we've also got a new effluent flow meter, so we're able to accurately record flows, which we did not have previously. Stage two, and what was promised in our application to the province, involves filtration. So once the three lagoons have done their primary treatment process of the wastewater, it would be then pumped through a filtration system to essentially, for lack of a better term, filter and clean the effluent even further to meet the more stringent regulations, which we, through my research, are actually now under. We have been under them for a while now, and we've been just basically existing non-conforming status. So we are obligated to meet the new regulations. Where we've run into a bit of a dilemma here is when we tendered the second stage of the project. The second tender, along with the original tender, put us approximately $1.2 million over budget. I think there's a couple of reasons for this. I think the original estimates were created in 2015, and I believe, and I have heard from others, including the province, that this is the case with a lot of other applicants, where they run into the same thing, where the market conditions have changed, and the construction costs have gone up significantly. Through this actual program, being water and wastewater fund, the market was flooded with these types of projects, and therefore costs went up. I think perhaps the initial estimates were not robust enough for this project, but again, that's hindsight, and we were talking back in 2015, so it is what it is. We got seven tenders were submitted, and they were all relatively close. So we do believe that, you know, we got a fair price for this second stage. So our options moving forward, I did speak to the province. The option of just not moving ahead with the project is not really an option for us. It's not looked favorably upon by the province. It is not done very often, only in extreme circumstances. The province does have other municipalities that are in somewhat of the same boat. And those municipalities, for the most part, have chosen to move forward knowing that construction dollars today are what they are, and they're likely just to continue to increase. So in light of that, I've been working with our engineering consultant to still accomplish the same goal of filtration, but to scale down the project to the point where it's accomplishing the same goal. However, the building will be much smaller. We may have to consolidate the electrical room into our existing building, which is tight for space now. You know, it's basically going from what would be a very, very robust municipal spec project with lots of space for our operators to work, to something that is still functional, still accomplishes the goal, but is maybe not quite as accommodating. So in order to do that, we've estimated what we can actually eliminate from. We propose to work with the low bidder. That contractor has indicated that they're willing to work with us on a reduced scope. We did seek legal advice as to whether we could do this or not, and we were given the advice that we can award to the low bidder and then reduce the scope and the cost by a change order. and deletions. So that's what we're proposing, but in order to actually accomplish the goal of filtration, we need some additional money. So this report is asking for council to authorize an additional funding not to exceed $520,000, $260,000 of which would be from the sewer development cost charges, and $260,000 of which would be from the sewer reserve. And this would enable us to complete the project at a reduced scope and meet the obligations of our agreement with the province.
Just a couple of quick questions, comments through to Mr. Kordolowski and Mr. Dickin. And that is, I guess first off, now I know when we applied for the grant, we were reasonably close to the maximum grant size, but we were not completely maxed out. So my question would be, what are the chances of talking to the good folks of the province and saying, given the change in market conditions and some unforeseeable circumstances, that we need a little extra from the province? I think it would be worth a try, personally. The worst we can get is a no. Best we can get is a thumbs up. So, Mr. Dickin and Mr. Kordolowski, whoever would answer this.
That was part of my conversation with the province, and I did ask them if there would be funding available. And they told me that the funding for the Clean Water and Wastewater Fund was 100% allocated, and there would not be any more funding coming forward.
Now, was there a general fund available as well that could be, I know there's some unallocated funds where they're not specifically targeted to a very specific purpose. So.
The response I got is there was no further monies to be had.
Okay. And the other thing, and this is maybe something that we'll have a dialogue in a future meeting, is I'm just very keen on ascertaining that consulting advice that we received from the get-go was very accurate, and I would like to get a staff report for an in-camera meeting coming up just to make sure that indeed that was, and the reason I suggest in-camera is if it was inaccurate and crappy information, pun intended, that we should investigate our options because obviously we made decisions based on information. If that was inaccurate information, then we can deal with it. Just to double check to make sure that the information from our original consultant is very accurate. I'm just finding the best.
We can explore that.
Okay, that's good. So the good news is we do have the money in reserve funds. This will not be hit on the taxpayer. It will be a last minute increase in taxes, of course. This is money is in the bank, as it were. Correct, Mr. Forrest?
That's correct.
Okay. So maybe we'll put the motion on the table and then we can have some discussion on it. Okay. Second. Councilor Croft, Councilor Medlock. Council discussion. Councilor Medlock starting off.
Thank you. I guess my question is sort of partially been answered, but just looking back at our year-end financials here, the sewer reserve had, in 2017 at least, $566,000. So were any of those funds to be used for any of the projects this year or in the next 4 or 5 years that would change any of those projects?
No, the sewer reserve is basically established for sewer capital projects. In discussions with Kevin, and coming up with this $520,000, I thought it would be best that both reserves are supposed to be around $550,000, if you want to call DCC the reserve, not the reserve, but the DCC's bylaw that was established, there was other projects noted other than PCC upgrades, so didn't very well just complete
that's kind sewer of
DCC, at. So I was suggesting that that's kind of what happened now. So we're not completing the sewer reserve completely because suddenly you come up tomorrow to, you know, a lift station or whatever. So and we're constantly every year in the budget contributing to the sewer reserve to replenish it. So I think we've already got a contribution in line for this year as well. So we're always trying to, you know, continually replenish the reserves. I mean, that's why the reserves are there for unforeseen idea events like that we're facing. So I'm comfortable with it.
Okay. question is, pretty sure when we agreed on this project that we decided to include like ozone machine or something for the final output of the effluent. Is that part of this filtration system, or has that already been taken care of in the phase one?
No, the, that was unique disinfection. We felt from the get-go when True Consulting took over the project that UV filtration would not be needed at this time. They felt at that time, looking at the budget, that we wouldn't be able to accomplish it. And now they are correct. They've been proven correct in that regard. We are actually currently meeting the new stringent regulations just with the upgrades that we've done so far on stage one. However, it's the TSS requirement that we will have a hard time meeting without that filtration because in the summertime, when we get heavier flows, and also you end up getting algae blooms in the lagoons, we need to filter that out in order to meet the new stringent regulations. So the UV portion of the original stage two was to be well set up for it, have the plumbing in the ground, so to speak, so that the addition of UV, should we ever need it, would be, the initial plumbing, so to speak, would be done, so it would be a more simple project, but that's something that we're going to have to eliminate now that we don't have the adequate funds.
Okay, and where I was going with that addition, I thought it was ozone UV, for the correction. The idea to go with that was so that we would meet the standards into the future. So now, that eliminated, and whatever we need to do to get this project within budget, I heard 1.2 million over budget, and we're only asking for 520, so obviously with the other sections and building size and the electrical room, where do we stand as far as, where do we see how long is this project going to last into the future before we have to put more dollars into it?
I'm pretty confident that UV is a long way off, if at all. We're already meeting the regulations with the improvements we've made. And I think with the filtration, that just allows us to take our already compliant effluent and make it much better.
So you have years and years of capacity, if you will.
That is my opinion, yes.
If I could just, for council's benefit, the way that 520 came about with the code, additional 1.2, is after stage one was completed, and we were there last, in our office there last week, I think it was, I think there was around 750,000 out of the original project that we still had left. So we're, without this bad news, we're thinking that stage two would be around 750,000 and we would have met the 2.4. Well, the project was 2.9. However, that wasn't the case when the tenders came in. So if you take the balance of the original amount plus the 5.2, that's where you get the 1.2.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
For Kevin, I just want to try and clear up the numbers. The stage one process, what?
Stage one was $1,839,125.
Okay, so, and out of that, we have 2.9 million. That was the grant proposal that we got from the grant. So we should have still $1 million, roughly, sitting around.
We have 782,000.
Sitting around.
Yeah.
This is for stage two?
Yes.
Okay. So you have 700 and you want another 500?
Yes.
So that's 1.2. So that'll cover the total cost of what we needed to do. So we should get full.
No. So the low tender for stage two came in at $1,731,000. So we need to get the scope of the project down to 1.2 million to be able to build it.
observation. I know that there's more and more development, residential development going in, and my concern is by limiting the scope of the work that needs to be done. And I mean, you partly answered the question that you feel that it's adequate at this time, but I'm just, I don't know if we can borrow money to do what it is that we want to do. I'm just concerned that we're doing something and then in 5 to 10 years, we're going to have to just redo it again to enhance what it is that we should have done when we're already there doing what we need to do. So I'm just concerned with all the residential development that's happening within the community if this isn't the time to do what we need to do with prices the way they are, because in 5 to 10 years, prices will be up. We're looking at $500,000 more on top of, right?
Right. Through you, Your Worship, the reduction in scope is not going to change the capacity of the plant. It's mainly just the reduction in size of the building, but the filters are going to stay the same. The lagoons are as the lagoons always were. The size of the filters are going to be the same, and we're going to be able to push the same amount of effluent through them. So that aspect of it is not changing. It's other changes to the project that are.
So it's the building.
The building size will be smaller. The electrical will be moved to the existing building. Things of that nature.
Mr. Dick, could you please hold your voice, please, because the noise is always loud enough. Speaking louder than I think there.
Thank you. Through you, I'll wait till Mr. Davis returns.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I'm just wondering when we do these grant applications. Now I'm not sure if it's something that we need to be thinking about in the future or if we need to be addressing it at EPCM. But at some point, when we're going to be phasing projects, then maybe we need to be thinking about, you know, in 5 years, the dollar values are going to change, and they always have, and they always will. So there's got to be some sort of leeway in there for us to adjust the next phase somehow. And if we're going to be contingent on the second phase of upholding the grant status of what we need to do, then there has to be something in there that we can look at for the future. Because right now, I mean, you know, our hands shouldn't be tied because the dollar value has changed. I mean, we had to downscale everything. I mean, the men still have, or women, whomever, has to still work in the buildings and do the same functions. You know, it's going to be a little cramped now, and it's not the most pleasant experience, I'm sure, to be working in that area anyways. So, I mean, in those kind of cases, it seems to me that we should be, you know, I appreciate that you'd already addressed this with the province, but maybe politically we need to look at this for the future. And if staff has any ideas on what we actually need to put together as a request or a proposal for UBCM, I'd be interested in hearing this, because I think we need to say, you know, if this job, and sometimes unexpected things happen and we have to extend the grant because of, you know, weather or labor or whatever the issue might be, material. So again, we get penalized if we don't, you know, meet that specific requirement. So I think we need to, and we can't be the only community that's living through this. So we need to, these are really important jobs. I mean, water, sewer, garbage, all those kinds of things, those are essential services. This isn't something that we can, you know, just say, oh, well, we'll just pull $1 million, you know, out of reserves so that we can, you know, complete this phase two. That's not really fair. So we're not really looking, we're looking at that more as a capital project for the future or, you know, whatever. So if you have any comments on that, I'd be quite interested.
I think it certainly probably wouldn't hurt to send a letter into to whomever it should be sent to bring up the subject. I know we're not the only ones in this boat. The feedback I got from the province, so they're acutely aware of issues that have arisen out of this particular grant fund. You know, we also experienced some delays early on, with the inability. contractor, that didn't help. Luckily found a really good contractor. But we only, you know, we were at the point where we were trying to drum up interest in the project at the beginning, which was very frustrating. We didn't expect that.
So thank you for that.
Yeah, I like, Councilor Croft, I like your idea, sort of an inflationary adjustment mechanism so that if prices have gone up a certain percentage of the grant gets bumped up a little bit, that would be very good. I still think it would be worth it for us to, since this is a freestanding phase, I would still support a meeting with the minister responsible and see if there's any monies out there that we can. I certainly appreciate and respect the staff effort to go after additional monies, but I think maybe a slightly more aggressive political approach might be worth an effort at least. Mr. Porlowski and Councilor Dyle.
Your Worship, two things on the comment from Councilor Croft. I agree. I think strategically, the province should identify a reserve in and of itself for the largest project categories. Because you are by contract, and this is for this project as well, we have to complete everything that's described in the project definition. So what they will do is generally, if there's an underspend, they'll allow you to enlarge the scope and spend to what they've allocated. They don't allow you to ask for more money. You basically tied your hands through the agreement to achieve everything you agreed to and you've got the grant for. So I don't know necessarily how successful Your Worship, a last-minute lobbying effort would be. I suggest that may be a long-term goal, but respectfully, we'd like to get the project done, and that's why Kevin's brought the report in to you and council. As for the other topic you're bringing, we'll come forth with some information to council as requested about estimates.
Yeah. Well, I guess I'm very much in favor of trying it at least. The only reason we can complete this project with the reduced scope is because we have a well-run district and we have the reserve funds available. If we would not have the reserve funds available, we'd be up to speed without a paddle, so to speak. So, it's Councilor Dyble.
Thank you, Drew. I'm just wondering if you want to put a motion for taking the VCM for the members to consider. The province to have that as part of something that they have in their packages, a contingency fund in place for phase projects. And I don't know, I'm not going to UBCM this year, but maybe there's a meeting that can be had with the minister as well, I mean, not on this particular topic, but just in general about this. So have it as a resolution plus as a meeting point.
Just Ms. Bellingham, where are we at on the motion stage here?
You've got the motion on the table, no vote, and then
so let's get that motion tucked away, the first one. If council is amenable to the motion on the floor pertaining to authorizing the reserve fund expenditures, a motion.
So moved.
Okay, now we got the motion.
Oh, sorry.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Contrary? Motion carries. And then I guess Councilor Croft, Councilor Dyble on the motion to send a letter to the UBCM?
Support their resolution.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Your Worship, I have to do some research. It may be a little late to get it on the resolution. However, I suggest for one of our topics for ministerial meetings, it would be appropriate to do this as a first step and then see how much support we can get from the other member municipalities, and then it would naturally develop into a resolution.
Okay. So maybe a motion to that effect.
Sure.
Set up a meeting with the pertinent minister.
I'll second that, of course.
Okay. Move second. Those in favor? Contrary? Motion carries. Very good idea. Okay. Mayor and Councilor reports. I'm going to keep it relatively short here. And I'll skip a few things and then tuck those into the next council meeting. We'll have a couple of years before dragging on in the evening. So I went to the Aboriginal Day in the park. Peter's family did a great job organizing it. And Councilor Bible was very active there doing her thing. And just it was good to attend, celebrating Aboriginal culture in our community and region. Attended a University of the Fraser Valley board meeting, and that was in Harrison. Gave them a little update on what's happening, what has happened in Hope over the last year, and also respectfully suggested they should come and have lunch. college at maybe at some of the district expense, explore the facility we have in our community and see if that's adequate for future needs in their opinion. It might be a good opportunity to up the game a little bit. I suggested maybe a university-credited hospitality training program would be a good fit for our community as we are very tourism hospitality-focused. So we'll look back on that. I received some correspondence from the school district pertaining to that. I'll talk about that at the next council meeting because that will generate a little more discussion. We may not have time for tonight. Joint use agreement. Many of you are well aware that the joint use agreement between the Rec Commission and the school district, new joint use agreement, had a year of success. So we had a little coffee, tea, and goodies session at the Rec Center the other day to celebrate that. So the school board members came by and the Rec Commission members came by, and so that was a good thing. And the crosswalk issue, Councillor Stone brought that to my attention. Citizens talking to you, I guess, and he'll speak to that, I guess, under your report. The writers, yeah, the point brought up during the public hearing pertaining to proper access, safe access to Ryder Street and the surrounding areas. So we'll probably have to have a dialogue with highways on that. Ministerial meetings, when, Mr. Fordowski, when is the deadline for UBCM ministerial meetings?
13 July, Your Worship. I sent out emails.
Yeah, exactly. Just double checking there. And so maybe for the in the next couple of weeks, we can trade notes and make sure that we're all on board with who we should meet. And it's a good opportunity to talk to the Premier and respective ministers. So we'll make sure we get maximum mileage out of that. And then our MLA was in town on the weekend. Jackie Taggart. Had a nice visit with her on various topics, and it's good she's showing her approachability because it is kind of an onerous riding that she's representing. But the one point that particularly stood out in mind was a discussion about proportional representation, which would be a considerable dud for our community because if the provincial representation is based on percentage of population. I know the Green Party is very excited about proportional representation because it would guarantee them more seats than they currently have. But I think for small communities, there could be a bit of a problem there. I know MLA Taggart had some serious concerns about what that would do to provincial politics. I would like to I know staff is super busy, but maybe for the next council meeting, there's been some fairly robust discussion about proportional representation, and I would like to have a, in the near future, have a council position on this matter with some proper discussion. And I don't think it's going to be a particularly controversial topic, because I think for small communities, for the most part, it's not going to be a real winner. But I think it'll be a pretty easy thing to decide on, but maybe we could have that as a topic for discussion, maybe at a committee of the whole meeting. So it's worth a discussion anyways, because it would definitely change the provincial landscape of our province, so it's worth a chat anyways. And I'll cap it at that, and maybe we'll start with Councillor Croft.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just like to extend an apology that I was not here at our last meeting. I had bronchitis, and I was very, very sick for also. Didn't want to get anyone else sick, so thank you for
thank you for not sharing.
Thank you.
So thanks for excusing me on that one. Just like to say that I realize that we kind of had winter and then summer, and now we feel like we're back to winter again. So we've had a lot of tourists around town, and they're really well. I've received many positive remarks about our community, about our park, and about our nice planters, and all the things that Communities in Bloom is doing, and all those nice things. So kudos to everyone for all their work, and the staff as well, keeping things clean. I did get a few comments that there wasn't enough doggy bags out there in the park area for the containers. So I know that staff would be really great about donating doggy bags themselves, actually, for whatever reason. council, I think we really need to work that into the budget somewhere. We need dog bags for every park. We want to have a clean park with lots of kids and people walking and town, so maybe we can look into that. The other thing I'd just like to say is that the Park Street Manor is, they're doing very well, and they have vacancies, and so if anybody's interested in downsizing and going into a very nice family environment and with good people around them and entertainment, the Park Street Manor is a senior complex. Everybody has to be able, they have to do the litmus test of the steps, and if they can get down those, they're in. So it's a great place, it's reasonably priced, and they get all their meals and that. So if you have any questions about that, anyone, let me know. I'd be happy to pass it on.
Is it a fair question to ask how much it is per month now? Is that,
Yeah, I think it's around the $8.50 mark.
Okay.
So it's quite reasonable for all your meals in your month, and the staff go over and above. They even take people to town, and you know, they take them on outings, and I mean, gosh, if I wasn't married, I'd be in. Wonderful. But anyhow, so yeah. So thanks for that.
Thank you. I don't think Michael would appreciate it.
I don't think he wants me to go out on him to go and be fed and well looked after. He likes my cooking.
Thank you, Councillor Croft. Councillor Erickson.
So I missed the last council meeting too. I was on a humanitarian project in the Isle of Dominica. Island of Dominica, it's just north of Barbados. Spent 2 weeks there. I don't know if you heard that the island was devastated by a hurricane, Maria, last November. The island has 78,000 population. Half have moved off. 85% of the homes were destroyed. And when you fly in, it's the whole island's mountainous. There isn't a level spot in the island. Thacker Mountain is a nice level road compared to the island. I'm not joking. The island is just up and down. Anyway, each little village, the week I was there, they finally got the power restored to all the villages around the island, but not to the homes. They just got the main power line. I've never seen devastation like that in my life. I've done quite a few humanitarian projects, but this one is the worst. The trees were just shredded of all the branches, and so they're all sticking up. It's starting to come back after the 9 months that the banana tree is starting to grow. But it was a very hard working 2 weeks for us. We built a church, and the church was going to be acting as a public building. It's engineered to withstand 200 mile an hour winds. They had the hurricane, the eye right over top of the islands, and so they had 175 mile an hour winds sustained for 2 days. So it was really bad. But they were really appreciative of us. It was a 3 week tour. I only spent 2 weeks there. So that's why I missed the last council meeting. So another thing I'd like to bring up is for Kevin, I really appreciate all the public works you've been doing this year. There are just numerous projects that you sent us, and I really appreciate the update on it. But I'm just wondering if we could get an update on the cost, the final cost on some of these projects, if it was in the budget or the budget. It's just good for us to know where we are in the round and in the realm of costs. And another thing, I spent a day, more than a day actually, going on to talking to the new businesses that are in town, like Starbucks and the mattress company and Reveille's and the Buckle. And anyway, you just went around the town, and I really had some great news for the district. Everyone was very appreciative of what you're doing, Jazz, and the speed that the permitting process and how the district has been working with them. It was really, really positive to see, and I just thought I'd bring that to you guys. Dave has done a really, really good job. They said it's like, Starbucks said it's nothing like other projects they've done. Big problem with Starbucks, they haven't got power hooked up yet. Hydro's holding them. Maybe they did today, but it was a Friday. So they were really, really hoping for power. But anyway, all the new businesses, hope is really doing well, and the new business is coming, and the new business are really happy how the permitting process is going. So thank the Jazz and Kevin and John and all the staff for doing such a good job. Now, another thing I'd like to bring up is remuneration for council, the task force for the council. I proposed a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago, maybe 2 months ago, and I would just like to keep council informed that the renomination process is in progress. I'll just read just part of it, just the guidelines. The task force will research and consider all aspects of compensation that it believes is relevant to making its recommendation, but specifically consider the following matters. Compensation paid to counselors must be sufficient to attract individuals from all walks of life to offer to stand for election and not to the municipal public office. And then the functions of the mayor and council, the level of community engagement, and the time commitment required of individuals holding municipal offices. This remuneration will be, they'll choose a task force of a few people, probably five, and it'd be chaired by one of the senior staff members. And I would really like to see us push forward it so that it will be in effect, the remuneration will be in effect for the next council. It doesn't affect this council, but the incoming council. And I'd like to see, John, if you could go ahead and move with this as quick as possible, if that's what council approves. I think you should go ahead with this as quick as possible.
So you, need to pose a resolution?
Motion?
For that.
Resolution, yeah, for that. So does staff have that within their available time?
It would be tight. We would have to, over the summer period, you know, impanel whatnot. We could report back to council, I would say, the 17th of September with final figures for council endorsement. I believe that would be enough time. As mentioned, we have done up a draft terms of reference for you to consider should council wish to undertake the effort. So there is enough time if we are close.
So, can I make a motion?
You can certainly do that.
I'd like to make a motion that staff move ahead with this council remuneration task force and see if we can get it back to council by maybe mid-September.
So it was highlighted here no later than, you're saying middle of September?
17th September.
Okay. Motion's on the table. All those in favor? Contrary? Motion carries. Thank you. Additional comments, Councilor? Okay, thank you. And congratulations on that trip. I'm glad you're home safe and sound. Probably a bit of a risky venture going out there. But, yeah. It's nice you help others in that way. Councilor Medlock.
Thank you. Pretty sure it was last week. Yeah, I think so. Things are blurring. I went to the extraordinary annual general meeting, I guess is how it would be called, for the Chamber of Commerce, where they elected a completely, well, not a completely new board, but they have a new board, new executive. Stephen O'Young is going to be the interim president for a period of 4 months until their next regular annual general meeting in November. And he's got some great goals. He wants to see a lot of change and progression take place in the next few months. And I had a good long conversation with him, and I sat through the meeting and their regular meeting after the annual general meeting, and or annual meeting, I don't know what they actually call it. And it was good. They've got some good goals. I think they're very focused, and I wish them well to get some stuff done here in the next 4 months. Tomorrow there's an Advantage Hope meeting I'll be sitting in on, and on Thursday I'll be heading to Ashcroft for the Community Futures Annual General Meeting. And that's all I have to report.
Thank you very much, Councilor Medlock. Councilor Stewart.
So I also attended the Chamber of Commerce AGM on June 13th, and again, echo what you said, it looks like they're off to a good direction, so hopeful for them. Also attended the Golden Agers meeting, and we had some really good discussion. I brought forward the 17 projects that are underway, and they were really, really excited, and just hats off to you and the Public Works Department, and they're just so happy. So that's great. I did have a question about the crosswalks on Coquihalla Street, but I've done a follow-up with staff and pleased with the results. So hope to see those crosswalks on go to Hall Street done soon. And I went to the joint use agreement celebration. That was very well attended, I believe. I went to the National Aboriginal Day celebration in the park. I was there for the opening remarks, and then I had another engagement, so I had to leave, but it was wonderful. I would like to see that as an annual event, and I just think that they did a really great job. So the pedestrian crossing at Roger Street and Old Hope Princeton Way near the McDonald's, I sent an email to council and CC'd staff on a couple of pictures. So this issue was brought to my attention because my daughter lives on Scott Drive. She works at McDonald's. And she was walking home from work one day, a car failed to stop, proceeded to narrowly miss her, pull over to the side of the road, and call her a lot of very bad names for crossing the street and interrupting his travel. She was very upset and took to Facebook and asked people to please email the Department of Highways to make sure that these crosswalk lines could get painted. So it looked like there was quite a following. I emailed Sam. So that's great. But I think that with the development that is proposed for over on Roger Street and the increased number of people, that we need to look at a proper pedestrian crossing. And so I sent out a picture of one that is on San Juan Avenue in Victoria, and it's two posts with a push button so that it doesn't flash unless someone is going to cross. And so you push the button and then it flashes and it gives just a little bit more information that that is a crosswalk. That doesn't excuse the lines on the road, but I think that we need to take extra precaution in this area because it is a public safety matter. And I would like to know if we could put a motion forward to ask staff to engage with the staff of the Department of Highways to create or implement a solution similar to or exactly such as the pictures I sent out to council. And I would like to make that motion, please.
Good point. And yeah, with your permission, Councillor Stewart, maybe we could even get them to flesh it out a little bit because the corner by Coca-Cola Junction where the new Starbucks is going in, I think there's going to be a pedestrian issue there for highways. So maybe they could do an assessment of the whole Princeton corridor. And there might be some economy of scale. If there's a couple of pedestrian crossings required, that they have to up their game, that might be worthwhile doing both at the same time.
Your Worship, I've engaged with the province about the intersection as well, and I anticipate they'll be doing studies, or I'll be working with them to get studies done specifically with regards to a light, a traffic light. But clearly, should council resolve to move forward to direct us to work with the province, it does make sense from the economy of scale point of view to just have the traffic study include the intersection of Ryder and also Princeton and then look at an improvement as far as safety measures for a pedestrian, a lit pedestrian crosswalk.
Thank you. I do feel that this is a pertinent issue, though, and I don't want to get all bunged up on traffic studies. I think they need to understand that this is a very serious issue and that time is of the essence. That's just my opinion.
Yep, valid point. So are you comfortable with us focusing on Ryder Street, but also mentioning the Coca-Cola Junction corner?
Sure, I would be comfortable expanding it along the Old Hope Princeton corner.
So we don't have a
little bit of time.
We've got a
move.
Okay, good, we're good. Okay, so all those in favor? Contrary? Carries, thank you. Good point, Councillor Spoon. Thank you. Councillor Dowd?
Okay, just a few things. Met with Jackie Taggart, had a good chat with her on the health tax, which I brought forward at the last council meeting, that I'm hoping that we did forward off a letter to Carol James with respect to the implications of the health tax, and she had the same issues and concerns from the Liberal Party as well with regards to the health tax.
As well, a few weeks ago, there was an issue in the community with Fortis and the gas lines, and I spoke with you, John, with respect to that, and there was another issue last week as well. When I called Fortis, all they had indicated was there was a citywide issue. Well, there was nothing on their website, and nor were we notified of the issue. And that was the first time around. And the second incident that happened last week, and the concern is that you have this mass hysteria from the community that there's this gas leak, and really, in fact, what it was, what we were told when Fortis came out, was that they had just put too much smell in the line, and if you had a gas leak in your home, which most homes have small gas leaks, that it would smell even more. However, you have people who don't use social media for their source of information. So, you know, seniors at home wondering what's going on. You know, they're exiting their homes and standing outside their homes waiting for a technician to come 5 hours later. So I'm wondering if we could follow up with Fortis to say, what is your public statement when there is an issue of this nature? And what seems to be the problem that this has happened now twice in the last month? So I would appreciate if we could find out with respect to that.
Your Worship, we have been in communication, verbal communication with them. However, I think if it's if you're willing, we'll draft up a letter for your signature block, basically very strongly suggesting that they advertise and do a better job communicating issues like that in future with the district.
Yeah, and tying into that point, I certainly agree with all that was said, but I think the other issue is if it gets to a point where it's a regular occurrence, people get desensitized to it, so if there is a major gas leak, then people will say, ah, oh, this happens all the time, don't worry about it, and then we have a huge problem. So
we can include that in the letter.
Yeah. So we can include that in the letter.
Thank you for that. As well, when it comes to traffic, I'm just curious as to if we can request from the RCMP that they step up their patrols on some major thoroughfares, one of them being Kalpa Lake Road. Tourists head out to the lake, and they seem to think that it's the Coquihalla Highway on Kalpa Lake Road, and people are walking and riding their bikes, and you come around a corner by the fire department down there, and they cut that corner, and someone could be walking, and next thing you know, there's an incident. So I'm just wondering if we can step up the game out there with respect to some patrols, and I'll make sure that my left foot is not in place when I'm driving on that road, but I have noticed that. And the other thing is there is the homelessness meeting. We're now we want to change the name, and we want to call it HART, Hope Active Response Table. And that meeting will take place June 27th, 10 a.m. at the Fraser Canyon Hospital in the conference room. So if any council members can attend, I believe John and Mayor, you're on my list. So the rest of you are not, but if you're able to attend, that would be great. We want to look at doing a strategic planning session to look at some strategies to address you know, some of the ongoing concerns. So you're welcome to attend, and lunch will be provided. So don't get excited. Sandwiches.
That's okay. I'm a bachelor.
We'll
sandwiches excited.
We'll check the minute. Something tickles me that maybe members of council volunteered to be members.
Oh, okay. So I don't know who volunteered to be members of that committee, but yeah, it is open. So
yeah.
That's all I have to report.
Just a couple things to touch on. I believe on the crosswalk topic too, I brought this to staff quite a while ago, and John said they were going to try to get into contact with ministry, so maybe ministry dropped the ball on that, because I knew that just after winter that they couldn't do the line painting due to the weather at that point. And the other thing I noticed too, as being personally only in a boat, lake traffic has severely increased out there on the lake. And some pretty big wake boats and stuff like that are coming into the lake from out of town because there's charges at other lakes. So increasing our small lake, St. Caldas is one of those lakes that charges lots of places there to dump in, same with Harrison Lake. And these boats that are coming out here now at other communities, which is great, they're seeing our community. I think it might need to be looked at for the next summer and the next council there to maybe look at something that maybe it's a
charge on to non-locals for that. I know it's hard to monitor and stuff like that, but maybe during peak hours, there's a staff member that goes down there, because there's peak times that people use the boat launch. Some look forward down to the road there, but the lake is getting very busy. If you go down there on a Saturday, it's just crazy. You can look, and I go there and ask, where are you from? Chilliwack, Abbotsford, Mission. They're getting a lot of it, which is good that they're coming to see our community. But I think that we're getting increased traffic, and I think it's probably a nuisance to some of the people that reside on the lake as well, too, that should maybe be looked at down the road. So something for future reference. And other than that, nothing else to report.
Okay, valid point. And I just tack on to what I think was Councillor Erickson that mentioned, that the positive comments from business people and pertaining to staff and council, and just the speed at which things get done. And I know a lot of people in business, they deal in other communities as well, so they definitely have a comparison to how long it takes in other communities, and people are very happy, so keep up the good work. Much appreciated. So moving on to item 8, permits and bylaws. We have the Ryder Street, 1270 Ryder Street shopping. Okay, please note that Councillor Erickson is up to you. Due to, I guess, an ownership interest in a neighboring property, so, or close property. The application to redesignate and rezone the property at 1270 Ryder Street from institutional P2 zone to comprehensive development CD6 zone for Anhart Housing Society. We have a couple of motions that are here for council approval. Then we'll kick them off one at a time here, and then we can have some discussion. First one, that District of Hope Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw 1421-2018 be given the third reading in order to amend table of concordance to a CD6 comprehensive development as a compatible zoning category under the urban suburban residential land use designation. And further that, the Council of District of Hope has considered the duty to consult regarding the Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw 1421-2018. It concurs with the Director of Community Development that consultation be undertaken with the Ministry of Transportation and Infrastructure, District of Hope, Director of Finance, and District of Hope, Director of Operations. We have a motion to that effect, and we can have some discussion. Councillor Crop moving, Councillor Medlock seconding. Okay, motion's on the table. Discussion. Any discussion?
Sure.
Okay, Councillor Medlock starting off.
We gotta change that so we can have two on at the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah, we double the cost.
Okay, so the public hearing. The public hearing was good. There was a lot of valid concerns. I think got some valid answers to them. The reason I continue to support this is I feel like the Amherst Society's goal is to have a project that works for the community, and that they've done their due diligence and they're going to make this fit so that it's a successful project. They're not going to build something where there's not a need. The couple of concerns that did come up that I think I'm confident will be addressed at the development stage are the traffic concerns and snow clearing as to where snow will go. So I heard from Director of Community Development those things will be looked into at that time. Just checking over my notes here, I got a lot of notes. But yeah, I continue to support this. I think it's a needed thing for the community. I do know a family that lives in a similar building to this somewhere else, but it's in the United States. But either way, it's been a big change for their lives. They used that same model of percentage of their income, and when he lost his job, they were like, what are we gonna do? But the group worked with them to help keep them housed, which really boosted his confidence in looking for new work. So I feel like this is the type of project that would support something like that as well. And I continue to support it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor, we have Councillor Smith, but I think Mr. Gill would like to
speak. Just to add on to that, you will probably have to constantly assess the area as development sort of builds out. Even on Scott Drive, those properties don't necessarily require a rezoning. It just goes through a development permit right there, produce 11 or more units. And so, yes, there would be a constant assessment as to seeing sort of what the demand is in that area.
Councilor Smith, Councilor Kraft.
I think Scott already mentioned, like, I figured it under the development stage. I know there has been a few, actually, I have a family that lives on that street as well. Snowplowing has been an issue, it being not a priority road probably at that point in time. Down the road, if there's more apartment building, maybe it becomes more of a priority road for snowplowing, which I can see that being looked at. I know staff will do their due diligence. My one question is, with the zoning, doing rezoning this, are we held on how they're going to say that what apartments they're going to put in there? Like for the, say they want to put all the studios in. If we, with this rezoning, or is that at the development stage?
The bylaw is quite specific to the type of units. So if they're going to propose, let's say that they're successful with this rezoning and they're wanting to propose a change, it would have to go through a bylaw amendment. Okay. We would have to go through a public process once again.
Okay. I am in support of this project, but I do see that there should probably more apartments should be directed towards the single family housing end of it. Personally, I think with families that are coming in, with the new businesses that are coming into town, there's going to be some children and stuff. But I do have faith in Nanmark that they've done their due diligence. They want this project to work for the community. So if they feel that that's going to be the best way forward for them, I do have support in that. I do think that there might be a need to look at on the studio and the things a little bit more, but that's my personal opinion.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Councilor Kraft.
Thank you, through you. So first of all, I'd like to say thank you, Jazz, for doing your work to try to get things rolling with the development and that, and thanks for coming out and answering the questions again. Council looks for projects that are going to fit the needs of the community. When they come forward, we really do a lot of our own due diligence as well. And I think that the OCP is supposed to be a living document. Sometimes people feel things aren't credible when suddenly something might sound like it's changing slightly. And I'm hoping that we can kind of adjust our thinking to realize that the needs that are going to be met in order to make some of the projects work are going to be slightly altered. Because, I mean, financially, a bank isn't going to give anybody money if they can't pay the money back. So if something has to be altered slightly and it still fits the needs of the community, it's worth taking another look at. So I think we need to be a little flexible as a community. When we think about that, we do want to make sure that we are meeting needs that aren't being met right now. The different people that come in to work in our community, and we do need workers in our community. The community as a business whole is hurting for people that come in to work because there just isn't enough labor in our community, unfortunately. So if we can make our community a little more attractive for the workers that may come in the future, hopefully, and for the seniors that will be not driving around all over the place. And, you know, we've got a bus in town now. We've got care transit still running around town. We're trying to make our community as healthy as possible for all walks of life, and we're not pigeonholing anybody. We're trying to make it so that it's a viable community. I like this project. I liked it in the beginning, and I have faith in our staff that they're going to make sure that the OCP guidelines are met. And again, it's a living document. If we have to change some things in order to make things work, then that's what we should do. We are a living, breathing community, and everything changes. That we can count on. So, thanks for that.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Kraft, Councillor Dybul, Councillor Smith.
Thank you. I support this project. I think that when you're elected into a public position of this, sometimes you have to make decisions that aren't always going to satisfy every member of the community. And hope is growing, and the push from Lower Main Line is coming out this way for affordable housing, which we don't have currently in Hope. People are being displaced who are renters in our community because people are coming in and buying up homes and moving from the valley. So we're seeing more and more individuals not having homes who had homes in the past. And I think that, you know, as much as, you know, this rezone and the other rezone that's coming up as well, it's difficult to make a decision that we're used to a certain way, but we have to look at what the future holds, and that's what the OCP speaks of. And we need to be forward thinking and have a vision of a continuum of housing for the community that addresses all of the community needs. And I think that this is addressing those community needs. So I support this.
Thank you. And we have Councillor Stewart and Councillor Midline.
All right, thank you. So I have been one that has been sitting on a fence. I'm in favor, and then I was like, whoa, what's happening? So it's taken me a lot of work to get through the process to the point where I can confidently say that I will support this going through. And I say that with confidence because some things that came up during the public hearing tonight really solidified things for me. And one is that it doesn't meet the needs of all of the community. And no, it doesn't. But it is a beginning to meet some of the needs that are currently in place. And so we start somewhere. I encourage people to come forward and bring forward ideas that will satisfy the 2 and 3 bedroom and 1 bedroom model. But we need to start somewhere, and if we can take maybe some single people living in 2 and 3 bedroom units and give them a nice little studio apartment and free those spaces up, or I'm not sure exactly what the outfall will be, but I just feel that we need to start somewhere. I am going to support this with confidence and trust that the business model will be one that is a great place to start. So I support this file.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Just one point that Councillor Cropp brought up about the OCP and the wording that was brought up in one of these letters, maybe in a couple of the letters, was that they felt like we were in conflict with our OCP statement that is to encourage proposals that integrate affordable housing throughout the community rather than segregates or concentrates it in a specific area. I think when I read that statement, I look at it as we don't want to say that one specific area of the community is going to be specifically for affordable housing, that we'll look at affordable housing projects throughout the entire District of Hope, which I think we're doing. There's been a few that have come to mind, and you know, Park Street over here with the purple house that got torn down, there's proposed development there. The tenant type suites that are going in Silver Creek, along with single family, 32 lot single family residential in Silver Creek as well, and lots of development up in Cockwell Lake. So I think we're looking at a mix all over the community, and this is just one more piece of that mix, and that's, again, why I support it. So I think that statement can be read a few different ways, but I believe I'm reading it the way it was intended to be read.
Okay, thank you. And I'll throw in my 2 cents as well. I think, obviously, any decision council makes on this, someone will be feels their interests weren't met, but I think overall there's going to be some very good community benefit if this project moves ahead. I'm supportive of this with the assurance from the proponents that locals will be a priority in this. We have quite a number of folks who need a leg up, so to speak, to some help in finding housing and affordable rate. So if the priority is locals, I can certainly go with this. And it appears that proponents are people of your word, and they will do that. And that is something I look forward to seeing, because it is actually for young people and for people on a modest income, it is a scary time to be living anywhere from Hope through to Vancouver, because it is very expensive to reside anywhere now. So I think, in all likelihood, this project is going to be a huge blessing to the community. Also, the assumption is that the proponent will work very respectfully with the neighbors. So as issues pop up, that these issues will be dealt with in a very mature and respectful fashion. That's the expectation. I'm sure that will be done in the future. So we have a motion on the table. All those in favor? Contrary? Motion carries. Thank you. We got another motion here. Another motion tying into the same topic. A recommendation that District of Hope Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 1422-2018 be given third reading in order to rezone the property legally described at 1270 Ryder Street from institutional T2 to a comprehensive development zone CD6 zone.
So
okay, move.
Second.
Councilor Dybul, Councilor Smith. All those in favor? Contrary.
is the asphalt manufacturing and storage topic. We talked about it at one public hearing today. Recommendation on that one is that District of Hope Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 1429-2018 be given third reading in order to remove the manufacturing and storage of asphalt pavement as a permitted use in the light industrial I-2 zone. Motion to that effect.
So moved.
Okay, thank you. We have Councillor Smith and Councillor Kropp. Questions or comments? All those in favor? Thank you. Yes?
Asphalt remover and manufacturing, does that mean you couldn't store the road grinding on that property? That's exactly what it's for.
Which is that?
It was described earlier today.
Yeah.
No road grinding.
Well, that is okay.
That's okay.
Yeah, road grinding is okay. It's just not like the Herling Island model of processing pavement, getting it road ready.
Maybe this is an odd place to do this, but what if we change the wording to manufacturing and storage of manufactured asphalt?
If we change it, we have to go back to
public hearing.
Square one.
Okay, square one. Yeah, it has to be exactly to a T. Yeah. So, okay. Item C, and this is the matter pertaining to the Park Street development, potential development. And recommendation, there's a couple here, and put it on the table and have council discussion on it. District of Hope Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw 1423-2018 be given third reading in order to amend the table of concordance to add CD5 comprehensive development as a compatible zoning category under the urban suburban residential land use designation. And further that, the Council of the District of Hope has considered the duty to consult regarding the Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw 1423-2018 and concurs with the Director of Community Development that consultation be undertaken with the Ministry of Transportation Infrastructure, the District of Hope Director of Finance, and the District of Hope Director of Operations. Motion to that effect, please.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Councillor Smith.
Second.
Seconder, Councillor Kropp. Okay, discussion on the motion. Councillor Smith.
I just want to thank staff and actually the proponent as well, since our last public hearing that we had on this. What they brought back with for another proposal, I think they made some pretty good significant changes to make it that they listen to the public hearing, they're willing to work with neighbors. I'm gonna have support in this because of that too. I think it was a little bit much, and they come back with another option for us. I think this is gonna be a good thing for the community.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Smith, Councillor Kropp, and Councillor Hurst.
Thank you. Sorry. So I'd just like to say that I appreciate the work that staff and the developer have done to work with the community. Again, we know things aren't going to stay the same, and there was quite a list of concerns, and I'm sure that most of them will be met. Maybe not everything, of course, but I'm sure that a lot of it will be met. I'm really pleased and encouraged to see the willingness to work with the neighborhood. That's really appreciated. Thank you for that respect to our community. Really much appreciated. I'm happy to see that you did downscale it. You did, and that was a biggie. And I'm looking forward to new people in our community. And I'm sure with the amount of care and consideration you've given, that these will be very nice places to live. So thank you, and I do support this.
Thank you, Councillor Crown. Councillor Erickson.
So, through you, I have one question, and that goes to Kevin, regarding the drainage of the property. Does it have storm sewer access so the drainage can be drained into the storm sewers from off the roofs and off the driveways?
I'd have to specifically look at our drawings to be able to answer that, but typically with these type of developments, we request that the developer contain the stormwater to the site by a rock pit.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
That was
awesome.
Okay. Additional comments? Councillor Stewart.
I'm just curious, because of the developments we did out in Silver Creek, they were subject to the water study in Wabalabalabal. I'm just wondering, are these other developments also subject to that study being completed?
Question through to staff. Mr. Gill?
Water modeling capacity study, I believe it's called, Kevin. We will take any sort of development with that consideration at the time of the build phase. But right now, as it stands, it's just more for the land use to get the appropriate zoning in place.
Oh, okay. Next step. Yeah. End of the game again.
That's good, no?
So I do support this proposal, this rezoning going forward.
Okay, and I'd like to compliment the proponent for being respectful to the neighbors and taking in their concerns. I know it's the state of school has been around for a long time and there's development in a neighborhood in a small community, it makes it definitely ruffles feathers, and it's good to see that there appears to be a very respectful relationship there, and hopefully that will continue and calm heads will prevail on both sides. That's obviously very important. And as our IOCP, official community plan, indicates, we have to densify our downtown to stay as a healthy community, so this definitely follows in line with that. So we have a motion on the table. All those in favor? Contrary? Motion carries. Thank you. Second recommendation, that the District of Hope zoning amendment bylaw 1424, 2018 be given third reading in order to rezone the property legally described at 548 Park Street from single family residential RS1 to a comprehensive development CD5 zone. Okay. Moved and seconded. That was, I think, Councillor Erickson, Councillor Dival. Same topic. Additional discussion? All those in favor? Contrary? Motion carries. Item D, this is pertaining to 590 Opal Princeton Way, Summit Quest Properties. Recommendation here, a District of Hope Zoning Amendment Bylaw 1420, to given first and second readings in order to rezone the southern portion of property legally described at as 590 Opal Princeton Way from CD2 to commercial transition CD5. And further, that the public be notified in accordance with the District of Hope application procedures and public hearing information meeting procedure bylaw 1393, the Local Government Act and Community Charter. Motion in effect. Okay. Councillor Stewart, Councillor Erickson, and then staff speaking to it, Mr. Gill.
Did I hear CD of the nurse?
C2?
C2 and C5.
Oh, I'm seeing double here. That's reading up. Yeah, C, yeah. C2 to C5, yeah. Mumbling in the late hour here.
Your Worship, Council, the applicant would like the option of a retail use on the subject site. And the site we're talking about is Coquihalla Junction. That's where the Starbucks is currently being built upon. If successful with this rezoning proposal, the applicant intends to secure a retailer and construct store units specific to the future tenant's preference. The applicant would like to rezone the rear portion to about 1.18 acres from highway commercial to the C5 commercial transition zone. The remaining 1.24 acres fronting the Opal Princeton Way would remain as highway commercial.
Okay, first step in the process. Motion's on the table.
Move.
It's all we got. The motion is on
we're
the
there.
Table.
Oh, we're there.
Yeah, we're good. So,
all right, it's in
the
yeah.
You want to move? Okay, all those in favor? Contrary. Motion carries. Thank you. Item 9-8, information and correspondence. Motion received. Council Medlock. Second. Questions or comments? All those in favor? Question period. Public relevant to the agenda. Friendly, unfriendly, indifferent. All questions are welcome. Okay, our next meeting will be July 9th, and motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Okay, Councilor Crop moving.
Right.